Hey, we are here at the Istana Budaya, and I am joined by the creator of Video Games Live and video game composer, Tommy Tallarico.
Where is he?
He's right here, man. He's right here.
Oh, that's me.
Yeah.
Oh.
Welcome back to Malaysia. Hey. It's been 2 years.
I know. You've been bugging me on Facebook
for two years.
This guy, every week, he's like, come back.
Yeah, as an avid gamer and, a fan of your music, I'm really, really pleased to talk to you. So awesome. Thanks for coming out.
And thanks for representing Earthworm Jim.
Earthworm Jim, groovy.
Look at this guy, groovy.
Yeah, that's right, it. Right there. Okay, so for the people out there who may not know who you are, could you tell us like how you got into the video game industry?
No.
Oh dear.
No, I'm just kidding. Okay. See, you didn't know what to do when I said that. You're like, oh, now what do I do? No. Yeah, so I've been a video game composer for over 22 years, and the way I got involved in the game industry is when I turned 21, I grew up on the East Coast of the United States. When I turned 21, I got in my car and just drove out to California, which is 3,000 miles from where I lived, and my parents were crying on the doorstep. And I just went out there, no job, no money, no place to stay, nothing. I was literally homeless. I was sleeping under a pier at the beach. And first day I got there, though, I picked up a newspaper. I saw a job for selling keyboards at a guitar shop. And I went down there, and I had a video game t-shirt on. And this was like back in 1990, when not a lot of people had video game t-shirts like they do now. It was a TurboGrafx-16 t-shirt, if you remember that system. Might be before your time. But anyway, and the first person who walked in was worked at a video game company called Virgin. And Richard Branson was starting a company down the street. And they hired me right there on the spot. They're like, oh, you know about video games? Like, yeah, what do you want to know? And it's like, oh, you want to be a games tester? And so I went down there, and I was in California 3 days, and I was in the video game industry. And one of the first games they were working on was Prince of Persia, the original one. And I asked them, I kept bugging them. I'm like, hey, when you need music, I'll do it for free. And so they gave me the chance, and ended up winning a bunch of awards, and so they made me the music guy.
Pretty cool.
Yeah.
So could you tell us, like, what is your musical background?
I play music, I learn music by ear. So I never had a guitar lesson, I never had a piano lesson, I was able to listen to stuff, and I come from a musical family, musical background. I have a famous cousin who's in a very famous band, so I was always kind of growing up listening to rock and roll and stuff like that. So, and then when I heard Star Wars in 1977, when I was 10 years old, I heard all this amazing, like, symphonic music. But I never really, and that kind of got me into Beethoven. And so I listen to music and just different influences. Like, some of my influences, music-wise, are Beethoven for symphony music. That's how I learned how to write symphony music, by listening to Beethoven. Guitars like Eddie Van Halen, and I think it all kind of comes out in my own music. You know, when I play guitar, there's definitely, you know, Eddie influences, Van Halen influences and stuff like that. So just by listening to others, that's really, you know, when people say, who did you study under? I say Van Halen and Beethoven. Those are my teachers. Not bad.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
So what was the first instrument that you picked up as a child?
Piano.
The piano.
Yeah, when I was 3 years old, I started. The very first memory I ever have was, I remember sitting on a piano bench, and I remember I was 3 years old. I remember I was eye level with the keys sitting on the bench. And I remember like looking down and seeing like just massive keys. It seemed like they went on forever. I remember looking down that side and seeing keys forever. And I remember kind of like putting my hands on it and banging and feeling like this frustration and drive that it's like, I don't know how to play this and I want to learn how to play this. And so that was that kind of drive that I think from there I started to kind of learn how to play by listening and just playing back. So.
Now, when it comes to composing video music for video games, what is your process when it comes to composing a particular track?
Yeah, for me it's all about emotion. So I want to know what the character's feeling. Is it happy? Are they sad? Are they scared? Are they looking for something? Is something about to jump out? Or are you about to jump out on somebody? Are you chasing somebody or is someone chasing you? So to me it's all about emotion and melody. So I want a great melody, and then I want to bring in the emotion. And then, And then maybe I'll bring in the environment, you know, if it's a dark cave or if it's a, you know, an ice level or a lava level or whatever the hell thing they, you know, it's either one of those two, or a castle level or the toy level, you know, the fun house. And so, you know, but for me, it's all about emotion. You know, I want to know what's going on, you know, with the character.
Now, what is your fondest memory when it comes to making music?
Right here, Earthworm Jim. Yeah, for sure. I mean, Earthworm Jim was such a great project because it was basically like 10 guys in a room all trying to make each other laugh. That's what Earthworm Jim was. And so, you know, it was total creative freedom. You know, we were just, you know, sitting around a table and we're like, oh, what? You know, he's gonna ride a rocket ship.
And the asteroids.
Yeah, I don't know, let's do banjo music. Well, why? I don't know, because it's funny. Yeah.
Well, what the heck, where there's an elevator music.
Let's do elevator music because you're in hell. Yeah. So, yeah, if I was in hell, you'd want elevator music. But then we mixed that with, like, you know, cool rock and, you know, kind of electronica pieces as well. And you know, so one level you'd hear rock and roll, the next level was polka because we didn't care, you know. One level would be a guitar, next level was an accordion, you know. So why not? Who cares? There were no rules, and so we broke them all. And so that was a really fun project. To do, yeah.
Now, over the past two decades, you've worked on hundreds of games, such as the original Prince of Persia, the critically acclaimed Color of Dinosaur.
Very big.
Yep.
And I, just to let you know, we're actually going to be performing the music to Color of Dinosaur.
Really? Just the three different notes? Eight different notes?
Narhiko is going to do it on saxophone.
Really?
I'm not even kidding right now. Yeah.
And you've worked on The Terminator and, of course, my personal favorite, Earthworm Jim, to the very underrated Advent Rising.
Yes.
And of all the games you worked on other than Earthworm Jim, which would you say was your second favorite?
My favorite score that I ever worked on is Advent Rising.
Advent Rising.
Yeah, and it's a shame because no one has ever heard it, but because it didn't sell that well. But I worked 2 years on the score. I wrote it as an Italian opera. Check it out on YouTube.
Check it out on YouTube.
You can download it if you want. The soundtrack, I mean, the score, the album for the game, this music actually sold more than the game did, I think. But that was one of my favorites for sure. I think as a piece of work, as a body of work, yeah.
Now, tell us about a television show that you co-hosted in. It's called The Electric Playground.
Yeah.
It left such an impression on gamers such as myself.
Okay. Were you able to see that in Malaysia?
Well, only the older episodes, like the newer episodes, like Judgment Day.
Yeah.
I that's the only one I watched, and then I watched the ones on YouTube.
How did you get it, though?
We don't have a G4 channel, but we had a different channel that pretty much had all the G4.
And it picked it up.
It picked it up. Cool. That's right. And could you tell us how that came about?
Yeah, well, basically, in 1994, it was the very first E3, and Earthworm Jim 2 was just coming out at the time, I remember, and we were at E3, and we were showing that off, and Victor Lucas, the producer of the show and my co-host on the show, wanted to interview me, and he said, hey, I'm thinking about doing this TV show, can I interview you? And I said, yeah, sure. So he interviewed me, and we hit it off really well. I was, you know, making him laugh, and I was being a smartass. And so about a week later, he called me up, and he goes, man, out of all the interviews I did, your interview was so great. Would you like to be the host of the show? And I'm like, sure, why the hell not? And so we were kind of forming the show. The show didn't get on the air till 2 years later. In 1996 was when we first started airing the show to the world. So it took 2 years to kind of develop it and film it and get the backing and stuff for that. But back then, no one was doing it, though. No one had ever done a video game television show like that talked to developers and talked to, you know, kind of behind the scenes and review games and things like that. So we were the first ones out there, and we're still, you know, to this day, you know, we've been running 15, 16 years now. It's insane. So still going.
And I heard that you guys won like a Guinness Book of World Records for the longest running TV show.
Yeah, we got a bunch. I got like, I think, five world records I hold. One is for the longest running video game television show. One is for the most video game concerts ever. One is for working on the most video games. Mm-hmm. Person who's worked on the most video games in their life, it's over 300. So yeah, a bunch of most video game concerts in a single year. Hold that record as well. So insanity.
And do you still keep in touch with Victor Lucas?
Yeah, yeah, on Facebook. He just had a baby girl and stuff. So yeah, we're in touch all the time. Yeah, people always want to know, like, did you guys really not like each other? Nah, it was all just show. And yeah. I played the bad cop. He played the good cop. And you know, we had fun with it. Yeah,
that's pretty cool
for sure.
So
I did get pissed off at him though. The legitimate time was when he gave High Heat Baseball
when he
gave it a 4 and it did not deserve a 4. That was pity right there. He was just giving it pity points.
And that was 10 years ago, right? You gave it like a
I'm still pissed off at him for that.
You gave it like a 0.5 or was it a 0?
No, I gave it a 0.
A 0.
Yeah, Men in Black got a 0.5.
The turnaround button you have to press the turnaround button just to play that game.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah. But High Heat Baseball got a 0 back then, deserves a 0 now. That was in 2003. That
2003,
came up.
Right.
And he gave it a 4, and I still give him crap for that.
How did Video Games Live come about, and how would you describe it?
Yeah, you know, I wanted to prove to the world how culturally significant and artistic video games have become, which is why I created it. Video Games Live is all the greatest video game music of all time, played by a full symphony and choir. But what makes it really special and unique is that everything is completely synchronized to massive video screens and special effects and a stage show production and rock and roll lighting and interactive elements with the crowd. So I kind of like to describe Video Games Live as having all of the power and emotion of a symphony orchestra, but combined with the energy and excitement of a rock concert, mixed together with all the cutting edge visuals and interactivity and technology and fun that video games provide. So I kind of like to have it, you know, it's a concert for everybody, whether you're into video games or not. I wanted to create it for everyone, you know.
And since Video Games Live made its debut at the Hollywood Bowl back in 2005, how has it evolved over the years?
Yeah, well, you know, we do a lot more screens now. So, you know, that original show had one screen. Now we have 3 screens. We use, like, we have, like, 6 different camera angles that we use. We have, the set list has grown massively. I mean, you know, back when we did our first show, we only had, like, 18 segments in the show. Now, after 10 years, I've created over 100 segments for the show. So the show's always changing. We're using technology now more in the show, so you know people can like choose the set list by texting on screen, and you know what song they want to hear next and things like that. So we're always changing the show, always keeping up with the times, always making it bigger and better all the time.
So there's a pretty good chance that for those out there who attended Video Games Live 2 years ago in Malaysia can expect something totally brand new.
It'll be 95% different. I kept a couple songs because people really love Shadow of the Colossus, so I brought that one back. People loved Chrono Cross and Chrono Trigger, brought that one back. So yeah, bring back a couple of the things, but even things that we played before, like Zelda, we're playing Zelda again, but a completely different arrangement. So even the stuff that we brought back, like Mario, Zelda, Final Fantasy, we're playing different songs.
Right. Yeah. Because I have to tell you, because 2 years ago when I attended Video Games Live, when it was first performed in Malaysia, I actually went to the show twice.
You did?
The day and the night show.
Even though it was the same thing.
Yeah, even though it was the same thing, I got my Earthworm Jim stuff signed, and you know, it left such an impression on me because, you know, it was, the orchestra was playing these music in the background, and you know, growing up as a kid, I was playing these games with my dad.
Right. Yeah.
And it brought back so many memories.
That's the thing,
it almost
right.
brought a, you know, tears to my eyes.
Eye. Exactly.
Yeah.
No, it's true, and so many people say that, you know, and that's the magic that happens, right? When you get a couple thousand people in a room together, and yeah, you're getting all these memories, because when you play a video game and you're that character, the music becomes the soundtrack of your life. Right? It's like that's your character and your, you know, thing. So it is really important, I think, that you know, Video Games Live is a complete celebration of the entire video game industry. And it brings up memories of when you were a child, and it brings up, you know, specific levels, and oh my gosh, I remember that, you know. So it's not only the music too, but the visuals as well, you know. And so when I create all the videos for, because I do all the video editing for all the videos as well, you know, I keep that in mind. Like, I want to show all the greatest scenes and some of the funny stuff or things that people would remember, even though it might not go along with the music that we're playing. Mm-hmm. But those images are so important. Yeah. that you know, I think it plays a big role.
And what has been the response so far from gamers and non-gamers of video games?
Yeah, you know, some of the best emails that we get after a show are from non-gamers. You know, for people who, because, you know, guys like me and you, we know how great the music of Final Fantasy is already. You know, we're not surprised. But for somebody who has no idea, and they come to the show and they're like, oh my gosh, I never knew that video game music was this beautiful and this wonderful, and the graphics are so incredible, and the characters and the storylines. I get it now. Now I know why my kids are so much into video games. Thank you so much, you know. So it is one of those things where, you know, that's mission accomplished right there. So when we can do that and get letters like that, we know we did it well.
And where do you see video game music heading in the future?
Well, video game music, you know, I just think you're going to just keep seeing higher productions. I mean, when games like Red Dead Redemption come out and the music in there just brought you back. L.A. Noir is another one where, you know, it brings you right into those worlds that they're creating. It's really incredible, you know, and I love the fact that more movie composers are now doing video games. I think that's great. I love the fact that, you know, like some of the big songs and you know, are being licensed into video games, and sometimes big artists write songs for video games. Yeah. I think that's wonderful. So, you know, I think that soundtracks for video games are going to get more and more popular. Mm-hmm. I think you're going to start to see them every year. The chart like this grows like crazy as far as video game sales and on the Billboard chart in the U.S., you know, games like Journey, for example, for the PS3, you know, it charted. It was the highest charting Billboard video game ever, even beat out Halo. So every year, you see more and more of that stuff, you know?
Right. And my last question is, I want to know, what are the top three non-Wikipedia facts about Tommy Tallarico?
Facts. Let me see. Does it say that I'm a vegan on there? I think it does.
Probably not.
But. Yeah. Well, so I'm a vegan, would be one thing. So I don't eat any meat or dairy or products at all. Let me see. Two would be I've never drank alcohol or smoked a cigarette my entire life. Never done drugs. So it doesn't say that on Wikipedia, and it should. And the third thing, I still sleep with my teddy bear. How about that?
Well, thank you very much, Tommy Tallarico.
Awesome,
thanks
thank
a lot
you.
For the interview.
Awesome.
And we'll be right back with Reviews on the Run.